We must remember that there were at least two purposes of music in the Confederate Army. One was to accompany the singing of the troops, and the other was to scare the Yankees. And we've seen both demonstrated today. I'd like to tell you a little about the ceremony you're attending. This ceremony has been held on this spot every year since 1914, when the monument you see behind me was dedicated by President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson. At least one of the presidents has spoken at this gathering, Calvin Coolidge. There may have been others, but it has been held every year without fail since 1914, and for many years unbroken yet to come, we trust. Our speaker today is Mr. Otto Scott. Mr. Scott is a business consultant, an author, based in Northern California near Sacramento. He's the author of a number of books. Perhaps the most appropriate one for our purposes today is to recall that he is the author of John Brown and the Secret Six, which was published by a unit of the New York Times about 10 years ago, apparently before anyone read it. And upon the editors reading it thoroughly, they discovered that Mr. Scott had uncovered some facts that some people thought were best forgotten and had drawn some logical conclusions which some people thought were best left undrawn. And the book was rather quietly suppressed. You can read the story of this amazing event in American publishing history in the spring issue of the Southern Partisan magazine, if any of you are subscribers there. We're glad to welcome Mr. Scott today. He has had a varied career, always involving the written word. He's consultant to Ashland Oil right now. He also is a writer for the Chalcedon Foundation of California, a contributing editor to the Conservative Digest, a member of the Authors Guild, the Overseas Press Club, a past trustee of the Philadelphia Society, and the Council for National Policy. He has won more awards than I can list here, and after you hear him speak, you'll see why. Mr. Otto Scott on the topic, Jefferson Davis, American Patriot.
Thank you. I'm greatly honored to be asked to speak on this occasion. President Jefferson Davis, leader of a second alternative American republic founded in this land, died about 100 years ago in New Orleans, and received the largest and most impressive funeral ever held before or since in the South. When he died in 1889, President Davis was 81 years old. He had suffered in the 25 years since the end of the Confederate States of America, a long campaign of abuse and mistreatment. Only toward the end of his life did a reconciliation between the South and the North begin to appear. This reconciliation was attempted by the generation that matured after the Great War between the two American republics. Part of that generation was Southern and represented the real lost generation, heirs of the Confederacy who matured during the occupation of what Pennsylvania Representative Thaddeus Stevens called the conquered provinces. This generation found its family fortunes destroyed and its prospects darkened, not only by the Reconstruction, but by the nature of the new Northern order. Other young Southerners poured west, where there was land to settle and to create new cities. But they could not escape the Reconstruction. Those who remained behind in the South experienced the new order at first hand. Their political rights were destroyed in favor of a minority. Northerners took command of their schools, their voting polls, their economy, and their society. But it would be a mistake to believe that the Reconstruction affected only the South. The fact is, the post-war Congress that took charge of the nation completely changed its economy, its social order, and its political rules. Northern states that had not previously allowed minorities to vote were forced to do so. Freight rates between the states were set to favor New England. The Western agitation that arose later, the Grange, and the populist movement and so on, was based on resentment of this favoritism. All this changed the country after the war. We haven't time, of course, to go into the specifics of that great collision between the two republics, to mourn over the 600,000 deaths and over the 400,000 recorded casualties, the battles and the generals, the victories and defeats. Let it suffice to say that it was the greatest of American wars and the greatest of American defeats. We haven't the time to go into admiration of how the Confederate States of America created a constitutional government in the midst of war, established its own currency and institutions, conducted debates, sent diplomats abroad, raised armies and a navy, created new industries, and conducted elections. All that we can say is that the leaders of the Confederate States of America maintained the highest traditions of this nation. Had the Confederacy endured, Americans today would have a choice so inviting, I believe the North today would be depopulated. But the Confederate nation was not defeated alone. The defeat was not that of one side, but of both sides. Both republics lost, because the issue was whether the states, as originally conceived, would remain free to select their own constitutions and style, associated in a common culture, linked by common ideals and a common constitution, or whether a new government, created by the heirs of revolution, would subdue the traditions of both North and South and create a new centralized authority. The South understood that. That was why a new alternative republic was formed, and why its people fought so stubbornly. The North did not, in the main, seem to understand that until after the war was over, and then great changes began that continue today. After the war, the treatment of President Davis revealed the nature of the new regime better than words can convey. President Davis was forced into a dungeon, manacled hand and foot, his sleep deliberately disturbed by guards who marched heavily back and forth under lights that were never extinguished. The manacles were removed in stages, first from his ankles, then from his wrists. After 2 years, the abolitionists slowly and reluctantly, like dogs letting go of a bone, allowed President Davis to be released to await a trial that never took place. I use the term abolitionist deliberately because that is who they were. Most historians today call the men who controlled the post-war Congress radical Republicans. That's a semantic trick, to trick people into thinking that the abolitionists vanished from the political stage when the war ended. Not at all. The post-war Congress was controlled by abolitionists. It was abolitionists who created the Republican Party, who staffed the large metropolitan newspapers of the North, who gained control of the northern universities, the publishing houses, and the state houses. These were the men who destroyed the Missouri Compromise, who raged against the Black Hawk and Mexican Wars, and who hated the First American Republic. Their desire, only partially revealed by the abolitionist argument, was for a central, all-powerful authority that would enforce social equality, limit all state and regional diversity, reduce the church and enlarge the power of the government over every individual life in the name of compassion and justice. It sounded wonderful. All inequities would vanish by becoming illegal. All differences would be ended by law. All discussions would end in the rule of the transcendentalists in the hands of the Secret Six, who were friends of Emerson and Thoreau and other abolitionists. This program turned out to use first propaganda and then terror. The propaganda started in the 1850s when President Franklin Pierce was in the White House and Jefferson Davis was Secretary of War. Webster and Clay and Calhoun were gone. A new generation was on the stage. President Pierce was an athletic 48, Jefferson Davis was 44, and considered the ablest man in the president's cabinet. Both were traditionalists. The Northern press foamed and raged against both these men and their attempt to govern according to traditional principles. The Pierce administration was politically wrecked by a combination of propaganda and terror. The propaganda centered on the situation in Kansas, where no black people were allowed, and where a new state was being organized. Senator Douglas argued that all issues could be settled by peaceful votes, but his hope and the hope of Jefferson Davis was lost when violence erupted in the territory. The abolitionists sent in guns and men and printing presses. Reporters appeared from New York and Boston, Chicago and Philadelphia. The high-speed penny press had just come on stream. Telegraph wires had just been strung across the plains. Events in Kansas were telegraphed to New York in minutes and appeared in headlines in hours. The northern journalists, looking for action, color, and quotes, printed sound bites, so to speak, found John Brown and his men, who had murdered peaceful settlers in the name, they said, of black freedom. By 1856, the Northern press had made Brown a national hero. He arrived in Kansas carrying abolitionist guns. When he left, he was on the abolitionist payroll. He provided the terror, and the Northern media provided the propaganda that made terror seem noble to the naive. And the Secret Six provided the money. And there you have the formula we know so well today. Very simple ingredients. They consist first of a murderer, cold-hearted enough to kill innocent, unarmed people in the name of a noble cause. Then add journalists who describe such murders as noble in the name of the cause. And finally, in the background, men who provide the money to advance that cause. When you add all those ingredients together, you have political terror made in the USA. Jefferson Davis was Secretary of War when the terror appeared. He was a very close personal friend and advisor to President Pierce. The press then, and historians later, darkened the image of that president and that advisor because they were on the wrong side of the revolution. For it was a revolution. It was not a crusade. It was not mounted out of brotherly love. It was a revolution that used in its course what Dr. Rushdoony unforgettably calls the politics of guilt and pity. The revolution continued through the Buchanan administration with increasing success. Not official success, but success in the press, success in creating violence. Jefferson Davis became, during the Buchanan years, a United States Senator from Mississippi. He watched as the agitation and the violence increased. Then in the autumn of 1859, a startling event occurred. An attack on the federal arsenal at Harper's Ferry, designed to provoke and arm an uprising. Violence had moved from Kansas to the South itself, to the heart of Virginia, led by a mass murderer in the pay and acting under the inspiration of six New England abolitionists, the Secret Six. The nation was at first appalled. Then, as Brown awaited execution, the newspapers of the North began to change his image. His courtroom speeches, heavy with biblical quotes, were made the subjects of editorials and sermons. Within a month, Brown was regarded not as a murderer, but as a martyr. When he was hanged, northern buildings were draped in black crepe. Funeral marches were held, sermons were mounted, and men wept. The South watched in horror. It became terribly clear that the North had been turned in favor of massacres in the South in the name of a noble cause. Southern senators and representatives came to Washington that winter, secession winter, carrying guns and knives for self-protection. For they knew that Harper's Ferry, after all those eulogies, would inspire more attacks, more raids, more murders, more efforts to create violent, desperate actions. But a new president had also been elected, and Jefferson Davis waited to see what Mr. Lincoln would do. Some have said later that the South should have relied on its Washington representatives to frustrate a minority president. But the fact was that words and votes were no longer enough. Propaganda promoting terror had appeared. In Lincoln's first inaugural address, he said the South could peacefully secede and no force would be used against it. Slavery was not an issue, but he said, we will collect the duties and imposts, but beyond what may be necessary for these objects, there will be no invasion, no use of force against or among the people anywhere. In other words, you can leave, but we'll continue to collect the taxes and to maintain a tariff upon all the incoming goods you receive from abroad. That was the trigger, and the gun was complete. Of course, that was all a long time ago. When Jefferson Davis was elected the president of the Second American Republic, he stood at the apex of a remarkable career, a career loaded with success in every venture he undertook, loaded with honors and prestige. But as one of the ancient Greeks said, count no man happy while he yet lives. The last 25 years of President Davis's life was darkened by many difficulties. Even in his 80s, he struggled to support his family. On his deathbed, he said, it may seem strange to you that a man of my age should desire to live, but I do. There are still some things I have to do in this world. What good does it do after all these years to recall the last times of Jefferson Davis? To revive Lincoln's role in creating a conflict and to stir up the bitter days of a vanished generation. After all, that war is a long time over. The Union was restored by force of arms. The alternative republic is gone. There are those today that would deny even its brief existence, who would forbid its flag from being flown or remembered, its dead from being honored, its leaders from being praised. But in reality, the past is not dead because it continues to influence the present. The truth is that the issues and the tactics that once tore this nation apart and that led to a second American republic remain alive. Immediately after the war between the two American republics, Congress seized control of the nation. Thaddeus Stevens said that an amnesty of the South would lead to Southern control of the White House and Congress. It was essential, therefore, to disenfranchise the South and empower the Southern minority to vote Republican. That would ensure Northern control for the foreseeable future, and so it proved. And long after that, of course, there was a period of reconciliation, or really of resignation. The last veterans of the Confederate and Union armies passed away when I was a young man. A new generation appeared, accepting the new order as something natural. The states gradually declined in importance. The diversities were reduced. The differences between the South and the North were accepted by mutual consent. The heirs of the abolition busied themselves making large fortunes, controlling the government, promoting prohibition, public education, and all the other causes they made famous. But by the late 30s, this seemed insufficient. It's difficult to define how and why the old disputes came to be studied and revived. It's as though somebody somewhere, somehow, looked at this nation and said it was once split in half. Suppose it's split again on the old issues of race and rights and Constitution versus arbitrary government. And in the usual manner in which such enterprises are launched, the Carnegie Corporation was persuaded to put up a large sum of money. And various university and political liberals were contacted, including Doxy Wilkerson of the U.S. Communist Party. The Swedish social economist Gunnar Myrdal was commissioned, and a study was launched under the title of The American Dilemma. This study focused on the remaining inequalities of position between the majority and the minority in the land. It appeared in two dense volumes in 1944, when we were involved in World War II. Only academic reviewers noticed it, but these two volumes ticked away like a clock attached to a bomb. After World War II, if you recall, books began to appear reviving the war between the states, Bruce Catton and his novelistic approach. long streams of such books. Carl Sandburg's Lincoln, sort of a newspaper biography, which came out to great rollings of the drum. The figures of the New England abolitionists reappeared. Theodore Parker, Gerrit Smith, and others became the subjects of new biographies. John Brown was resurrected. Tears were shed all over again about his hanging, his nobility, his efforts, with only passing references to his murders. All these books, like so many matches, emerged to light little fires in the mind of the nation. In academia, the Gunnar-Myrdal Project provided the raw material for studies and surveys, governmental programs, lectures, films, and thought. All this preparation was made during the late 1940s and early 1950s in an eerie replay of the arguments of the 1850s. The attitudes and the arguments of the 1850s were revived as though we had learned nothing from the greatest and most divisive of our wars, as though the Confederate States of America had never existed, as though the original constitution of the nation had never been changed by the practitioners of the politics of guilt and pity. And of course, you remember Little Rock and Ole Miss and the rulings of the court, the National Guard and the editorial and the marches and the demonstrations and the riots and the deaths and the violence. Propaganda and violence. Once again, the Reconstruction, the elimination of states' voting rights, the use of Washington to enter schools, not only of the South, but of the Midwest and the West, and this time even the North. And once again, a combination of minority votes were added to those of the modern abolitionists to master the nation. What President Jefferson Davis sought to keep from the South has now been planted across the entire country. The revolution never stopped. It only paused to gather its fruits and prepare for the next stage. And this time, unhappily, we do not have any Jefferson Davis. But now, at last, we can see and understand the forces against which he rallied half a nation. We can see and understand the people of the 1860s who did not go to war over minor issues, but over the principles of a free as against a forced civilization. It was not really the tariff, nor slavery, nor even states' rights for which the South fought, so much as it fought for the right to be left alone. The right to change its own society at its own pace and its own time, in the subtle and peaceful ways that societies have always changed. For men do not fight over issues. They go to war over visions. The vision of America, the South held aloft under Jefferson Davis, was of a free country. Not a country forced to obey orders because someone said the goals were better than the Constitution or the people. And these conflicting visions have not vanished. They are not buried with Jefferson Davis. It was the great error of the abolitionists to refuse to believe in the goodwill and common sense of humanity. They refused to allow time to adjust the inevitable maladjustments of society. They refused to let people work matters out on their own. And the result of that refusal was a great and bloody war and a nation psychically crippled for generations. We are today in the midst of a second reconstruction that is once again sowing the seeds of division in the name of unity. The unsafe streets of the Reconstruction South are now unsafe cities across the nation in the Second Reconstruction. The bitterness that separated people in the First Reconstruction has reappeared in the Second. It's not possible, of course, to say what lies ahead, nor is it within our power to say even what should lie ahead. God does not permit men to see the future. We are left with the past and the present, with its errors and triumphs, tests and results. We can only look back at our great men, at their examples of courage and truth, and among these, and especially among us here today, we count Jefferson Davis, president of a great though short-lived American republic, to pray that we can, at least in some measure, be worthy descendants of this great fellow American. Thank you very much.
Mr. Scott, if you'll step up here, we have a special presentation for you. This is a tie called the Confederate High Command tie. It was not worn in this country. It was worn by British sympathizers of the South. And this was brought out by Mr. and Mrs. George Taylor of here in Virginia. And I don't know if they're here today, but we want to present this with you to take it home and wear it when you think of us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to introduce the commander and the adjutant of Jefferson Davis Camp 305 for a special ceremony at this time.
How do you do? This is our adjutant, Alan Clark, Charles Goolsby. We have with us today a young man, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, he is a descendant of Jefferson Davis. And we are going to swear him in as the youngest and newest member of our camp. If Jonathan Moore will come forward. Will the adjutant present the candidate?
Yes, Commander. Commander, Mr. Jonathan Moore seeks membership in Jefferson Davis Camp Number 305 and in the Sons of Confederate Veterans.
We are gathered here to initiate into the bonds of fraternal brotherhood Mr. Jonathan Moore. We have a common birthright as Southerners and descendants of those who served the Confederate States of America. The Sons of Confederate Veterans is a patriotic organization not linked with any other organization, and is neither political nor sectional. We take justifiable pride in our Confederate forebears, men and women, who sacrificed their all for the cause in which they believed. The Confederate soldier won the admiration of the world by his courageous fight against an enemy overwhelming in numbers, equipment, and implements of war. With few exceptions, they were volunteers who fought for principles of government in which they believed. Although defeated, they left us with traditions of faith in God, honor, chivalry, and respect for womanhood. They left us a passionate belief in freedom for the individual. Our Confederate ancestors bequeathed to us a military tradition of valor, patriotism, devotion to duty, and spirit of self-sacrifice. When our nation no longer admires and pays tribute to these traditions, we will no longer remain a free nation. Now, having expressed your desire to join the Sons of Confederate Veterans, state the name, rank, and unit of your ancestor.
Henry Woodbury Moore. He was in a surgeon in Wade Hampton's Legion, and I'm not quite sure of his rank.
Captain.
He was a captain.
Captain. Okay. Chaplain will now administer the pledge.
The candidate will raise his right hand and repeat after me. I pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance
to the United States of America,
and to its Constitution,
and promise to defend it against all enemies. I pledge myself to loyally support. The activities of the camp. And the Sons of Confederate Veterans. Whose purpose it is. To cultivate
cultivate,
perpetuate, and sanctify the memory,
of the Confederacy.
In so doing,
I not only honor my Confederate ancestor,
but also affirm my loyalty and devotion to God. And country, which is so much a part of his character. Congratulations.
On behalf of the camp, Sons of Confederate Veterans, welcome to our ranks and take it more. Here is your membership card.
Thank you.
And thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, now seeing the Bonnie Blue flag, the words of which you find printed in the insert to your bulletin or your program, by way of explanation, let me say that we have concluded a concordat with our musicians. And the procedure will be this. Our musicians, led by Mr. Carroll, will play one chorus of the Bonnie Blue flag. Then we will sing a chorus. The first stanza printed in your bulletin, another chorus, the second stanza, another chorus, the third stanza, and another chorus. So they're going to sing, a chorus first, and then we begin singing just as it's printed in your insert.
Stand, please.
Thank you.